Numbers 28. We're plowing through this book pretty good here, huh? Another couple months, we'll be in Deuteronomy. All right, Numbers 28. Now, we've talked about this several times, but just remember, Numbers in the wilderness, God's a God of divine order. Amen? And God has a plan, and God is faithful to his plan, and God's going to bring about his plan even with unfaithful people, but the unfaithful people are just going to miss out on it, which is what happened to that first generation when they got to the land of promise and they refused to go in and they disobeyed God. So now we've come back to the second generation as an entire generation of 603,000 men above the age of 20 have all died. And now this new generation is there. And now when we come to, we've been seeing in the last several texts that even though that new generation is looking into the land of promise, they're so close, it's right there, that as we're near what God has called us to do, the enemy's always going to bring distractions. He's always going to try to draw us away. First, it was Balak calling Balaam to come and curse the people. God wouldn't allow it. So then they brought women into the camp and they fell for it. And we know 24,000 men who would have entered in died. Then we saw the number being renumbered again. And now that brings us to chapter 28. And chapter 28 and 29 are going to seem like very repetitive things, and in a way they are. But they're repetitive because they're being told to the next generation. And here's the reality. Guys, we need to make sure that we deliver the truth of God's word to the next generation. Amen? That we're not just satisfied with our walk, but we're giving it away. That we're pushing it down to the generation behind us. I'm so thankful that the generation in front of me, including my dad, was a pastor and one of the most godly men I've ever met, one of my favorite Bible teachers ever. And I'm so blessed because I grew up in that, and he passed that down to me and my family. And now my heart is, now I see it in my son-in-law who's pastoring a church, and my daughter, and my grandkids who talk about Jesus, and I love that. And so, guys, we need to give it to the next generation. We need not to keep it to ourselves. I think our first ministry, as the Word of God tells us, is our family, our wives, our children, our husbands, our family. That's our first ministry, and we need to make sure we're giving it away. And so in tonight's text, that's exactly what's going to happen, because the first generation have been given everything that they needed for a godly life. They've been delivered out of bondage in Egypt. God's presence was upon them. They're encamped in the cross. The tabernacle is there. The Holy of Holies is there. Godly leaders are there. And they still refuse to enter into God's highest. Guys, just because we have all that God has given us and all that we need, we still can rebel. And that's what happened to the generation previous. And now this generation is going to have its own opportunity. And I want you to notice, too, that even though the previous generation blew it, it wasn't an excuse for this generation not to obey. And too often that's what we see in the world today. Well, I'm like this because of my parents. And I'm not going to downplay having parents or growing up in a home or maybe not even having parents or living a rough lifestyle. I get that. And I'm not downplaying how hard that can be. But what I'm trying to say is that's not an excuse for us not to trust God. Amen? And it's not an excuse for us to live outside of God's will. And so Numbers 21, the next generation defeated the very enemy that the previous generation had not. The very enemies the previous generation had faced and run from, this generation fought them and got victory. And guys, my prayer is that my kids love Jesus more than I do, and that my grandkids love Jesus more than my kids do. Amen? I want the generations to grow more in love with Jesus as every generation goes. And we're living in a time when people are getting further and further away. So last week, if you were here, I titled the message, Raising Up a New Leader. Who took Moses' place? Joshua. Joshua's going to take his place. We talked about the fact that Joshua, the Bible talks about why he was chosen. He was a man in whom the Holy Spirit dwelt. He was a man who had walked alongside Moses during all this ministry time. He was with him in the wilderness. He went up on Mount Sinai and waited patiently at Sinai. He had been faithful. And I don't believe that Joshua ever thought or believed that he was going to take Moses' place. What he was doing was just being faithful wherever God put him. Guys, we need to just be faithful wherever God puts us. And trust that if God wants to use us in a greater way, he will. Amen? But God looks for those who are faithful right where you are. Don't worry, don't think, well, one of these days when I get to this place, then I'll let God use me. Let's be faithful where we are. Let's be faithful exactly where we are, doing exactly what God's called us to do, and trust that he will do even greater things. This guy served with Moses for 40 years. Now, the hip thing to do would have been to pick Phinehas. Who remembers who Phinehas was? What did Phinehas do? The javelin guy, amen? He won the javelin throw, right? Amen? He was the guy when when one of the leaders of the, brought in one of the prostitutes and took her right into his tent, and Phinehas saw that he was disobeying God, and he went in there and made sure they got the point, amen? And he drove it right through him, and you know what? God said that because he had done that, that God was going to stop the plague was going to come to an end. So he was being faithful, and it'd be easy to pick a young, brash guy, but notice who God chose. God chose a man who had led the army to defeat the Amalekites. He had ministered as Moses' servant. He was one of the two spies when they went into the land who came back and told them that we'll whip them. That's just what God said. They're going to be grasshoppers to us. He's the man that God chose. He had marched through the wilderness. He had witnessed the ministry firsthand. He was faithful to serve, and he was not striving for a position. That is a man or a woman that God can use. Amen? No striving. If you strive to get it, you're going to have to strive to keep it. Amen? If you force the door open, if you try to put yourself in a position like that, that's the place you're going to have to strive to keep. So the people have been renumbered. They've got a new leader. And now he's going to reestablish the sacrifices and the feasts. And again, this is going to seem repetitive, but remember, it's being told to the next generation. Guys, it's never repetitive. Let me ask you a question. I love every single time I hear a gospel message. Amen? I'm not exaggerating. I know I've heard thousands of gospel messages in my life, and I still love it. Amen? I still love to hear that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's one part of our text on Sunday, by the way. We're in John chapter 3. Amen? And I love to hear the gospel, and I love to hear the word of God again and again. And I've read the Bible from cover to cover more times than I know. But I still love to read it again. Amen? And so as he's delivering this to the next generation, even though we all know it, and maybe we've all heard it, and they'd been witnesses to it when they were young, they needed to hear it again. And because they needed to hear it again, we need to hear it again. Amen? So if you have your outline, in Numbers 28, I've got it there. I titled the message, Handing Down the Truth to the Next Generation. Telling them again. Reminding them again. And we're going to see three things that we'll see. First of all, when we have the truth given to us, what do we do? What happens? We rediscover God's plan. We're reminded of God's plan. You know, it's so easy, and let's be real transparent. You guys are the midweek study people. This is the core of this little church plant. Amen. How many of you have gotten so busy, and then you look up, and maybe you haven't read your Bible for 7, 10 days, 2 weeks? Anybody ever? And what happens? It does. What happens? You get dry, your focus changes, your priorities change, your passion will start to change, you'll get caught up in other stuff. But you know what's amazing? As soon as you open the Word of God again, what happens? Reconnect. You reconnect with the Lord, you get refreshed, you get hungry again for the Word of God, amen? And one of the reasons that they're going to have the daily sacrifices, that's the first one we're going to see, is so that they never forget. So that they're reminded daily of what God has done for them. They're reminded daily that without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness for sin. They're never to forget to take their eyes off of God. Point number two, when we hand down the truth to the next generation, we take time to worship, fellowship, and rest in Him. Notice I wrote down at the bottom, if you're too busy to gather with God's people to worship the Lord, you need to repent. Amen? Now, I'm preaching to the choir. It's Thursday night, and you're here. Amen? But the reality is, I'll be transparent with you again. I do not understand when people let anything get in the way of their relationship. I'm not saying going on vacation. Of course, go on vacation. I get that. But when I'm on vacation, I go to church when I'm on vacation. Amen. I love to, where are we going? Where's the Calvary Chapel? If there's not one, I'll find a Baptist, I'll find a church, amen? And the point is this, I go because I love him, because it's a get to, not a have to, amen? And there was gonna be monthly feasts and sacrifices that took place to constantly remind him to come into the presence of the Lord, to stop and be still, and to worship him. Guys, we need to take time to be with the Lord. Guys, if you're allowing any, if your job's getting in the way, you've got an idol that needs to die, amen? Do your job as unto the Lord. And you know, again, I've got plenty of issues, but I'll tell you what. I promise you I work as many hours as anybody in the room. More than likely, okay? When you count my commute and everything else, Ricky might have me, but maybe nobody else. And at that, and saying that, I only say that to say, guys, we can get here if this is the priority. Amen? We can open up the Word every day if he's the priority. We can spend time sharing our faith with others if we're looking for those opportunities. Amen? And guys, when you're close to the Lord, when you're walking with him, you're going to want to worship him. You're going to want to spend time in his Word, and you're going to want to be in fellowship, and you're going to want to serve others for his namesake. Amen? Point number three, last point, as you hand down the truth, you need to take time to celebrate and commemorate who Jesus is and all that he has done for us. Can I say this also? I don't believe that we'll walk around with horrible attitudes and feeling sorry for ourselves and murmuring and complaining if we are reminded daily of how much our Savior has done for us and how much he loves us. Amen? How valuable are you to God? When you think the world, you're not of value to the world, you feel like you're going through a tough time, I'm not downplaying that. We have difficult times. But you know what? Praise God for trials, because sometimes that's when we're most desperate for God. There's 36 guys out of that prison have given their life to Jesus Christ because they went to prison. Because that's how God got a hold of them, amen? That's how God got their attention. There's revival in that fire camp. Guys, sometimes when we go through the trials of life, just remember when we feel like playing Ain't It Awful, remember how much your Savior suffered for you and for me. We deserve it. He didn't. Amen? So we'll see you tonight. And then we're going to see these seven feasts. We're not going to look at all, which we're going to see a first couple tonight and the rest of them next week. But we're going to see that each of these feasts are done in memory of the Lord and looking forward to the coming Lord. At this point, they're looking back at different things that have happened, but they're also pointing to things ahead of them that they don't even fully understand yet. But as we look at these feasts, they're going to be reminders for them of the faithfulness of God. And guys, we need to take time. And I'll tell you something else. You can find out a lot about people by what they celebrate and how they celebrate it. Amen? In Santa Cruz, on the front page of the paper every year, Santa Cruz's favorite holiday, Halloween. And it was just, you know, you go downtown, it's a drunken brawl nightmare. And what you celebrate and how you celebrate it. Guys, if you think it's about an Easter bunny, let me introduce you to the risen Savior. Amen? If you think it's about a big fat guy climbing down a chimney, let me introduce you to the baby Jesus. Amen? The one who came to suffer and die, who might have eternal life. Again, let's keep our eyes on the Lord. Let's begin there. Handing down the truth to the next generation, rediscovering God's plan first and foremost through the daily offerings. Look what it says in verse 1. Now the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, command the children of Israel and say to them, my offering, my food for my offerings made by fire, as sweet aroma to me, you shall be careful to offer to me at their appointed time. He's telling the next generation, your parents got off track and you all watched them drop dead over a 40-year period. Everyone that he's talking to that was either very young, under 20 when they refused to enter in, or wasn't even born yet, they've been watching 2 million people, roughly, drop dead right in front of them. They saw the consequences of getting your eyes off of God and forgetting about God's promises. They saw what happens when you put your eyes on your own circumstances and allow that to keep you from stepping out in faith. And now the Lord's reminding them again Don't fall into the trap of losing hope and faith and taking your eyes off of me. And here's how you do that. Make sure you make the sacrifices as you were commanded at the times you were appointed to do so. Now, what's interesting about this, the word offerings here, or these sacrifices, it says are a sweet aroma and a delight to him. What is it that makes, and this is going to gross some of you out, but I love it. What is it that makes a barbecue smell so good? Burning flesh. Amen? Are we being honest now? What is that stuff that's on there, right? What's that hamburger made out of, right? It's burning flesh. But you know what I love about that? The Bible says that burning flesh is a sweet-smelling aroma in God's presence. And I think there's a couple of applications. First of all, when I die to my flesh, I believe that's a sweet-smelling aroma to our Savior. Amen? When I put my flesh to death, when I die to myself, only I can't do it in my strength, in the power of the Holy Spirit, that blesses our Heavenly Father. Amen? Now, that's not the direct application at this point, but I believe that's applicable. But what does this sacrifice ultimately point to? What's the ultimate fulfillment of every sacrifice? What is it? It's the cross. Amen? And the Bible tells us that it's a sweet-smelling aroma to our Father because it points to the cross, because the cross is going to restore sinful men and women like us back to the God who loves us, who created us, who'd rather die than live without us. Amen? So it's a sweet-smelling aroma to him because of the fruit that it's going to produce, because of the transformed lives that are going to come. And so as they're making sacrifices, not fully understanding that it's pointing to Jesus, our Father already knows. Jesus in heaven knows. And it's a sweet-smelling aroma because he knows what it's all pointing to. And so as they make these sacrifices, it's in preparation and pointing to the one who's coming. The Bible tells us, and when it comes to dying to the flesh, no flesh shall glory in his sight. Amen? And we all need to have a gut check on that. Amen? We can all get prideful. We can all think somehow we did something. And I want to encourage you, you know, this week, and God reminds me daily, I want to encourage you guys with a couple things. This week, in the last 4 days, we've got calls about the radio program, people that have given their life to the Lord, calls from radio program, people whose marriages were saved, calls from the radio, another call from the radio program, a woman and her husband going through a really difficult time, and then she went online and listened to the entire book that she had heard on the radio and called me up just to let me know, if you guys are going to plant a church out in Valencia, let me know because I'm coming. And then I had a man who somebody gave him a CD and he called me up. He got a CD a week and a half ago. He's listened to all of Romans and all of Acts, and now he's halfway through Genesis on our website in a week and a half. Because you guys are faithful to give, amen? And because people are faithful to make CDs, because people are faithful to do things. But the point is this, guys, when we lift him up, he is glorified, amen? When we point people to him, people's lives are changed. We point people to us, they're going to be disappointed because we're a mess. Amen? We need to point them to him, not to us. And let's be faithful to God's calling upon our lives. Spiritual desires focus on the Lord and his glory, not wanting something from the Lord. When you come to the Lord, why do you come? Are you coming? Gimme, can I have? Gimme, can I? Gimme, gimme. Now again, there's times to pray and ask, Lord, if it's your will, you know, I'm up for promotion at work. Lord, your will be done. Nothing wrong with that. It's okay. But we need to trust that if God says no, that we praise him anyway. Amen? That we seek after his will, not our will. That we don't bring glory to our name. And if anything good does happen, we make sure that we point to the one who allowed it to happen, who gave us the gifts we've been given and has shown us the mercy we don't deserve. Amen? So he says, do this. This is an act of intimate fellowship with God. It's, again, that's what God's desire is. And notice he says, at their appointed time. It wasn't just make the sacrifice, but make the sacrifice at the time you're called to make it. And why is that significant? Because we know that the sacrifices were pointing not only to things behind them, but things in front of them. The Passover, looking back, as we'll talk about, at God's deliverance out of bondage in Egypt, is also looking forward to what event? The cross. Amen? When did Jesus die on the cross? Passover. And so when they're looking back, and he's got the appointed times, because all of it is according to his perfect will. It's got an ultimate plan, but also the daily sacrifices, so they would wake up in the morning and their first thought would be to honor God and sacrifice. Before they went to bed at night, it was to go and make sacrifices to the Lord. Guys, if we begin our day with him and end our day with him, we're going to spend our day with him. Amen? And that was the calling, he says, at the time I have appointed. We're going to see some are daily, some are weekly, some are monthly, some are yearly, and they had to be about it, to remember. And when you do that, what does it do? It ministers to the next generation. Amen? You know, when you instill something in your, and you make, you ask for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. My kids growing up, we missed a lot. I love sports as much as anybody, but I love God a lot more. And so my kids, we're at church. Well, that sport's on Sunday. We're not playing that sport then. Amen? And I know a lot of people, elders in churches and people that serve ministry, and their kids will be gone from church for 5 months because it's, you know, it's soccer season or whatever. And I'm like, you just told them that God is, that soccer's more important than God. Amen? And we must never, ever fall into that trap. Guys, the way you raise them, the way you give it away, and we all need to do that, even if it's not your own kids, give an example to that next generation that's coming behind you of what's really important. Amen? And you've heard it said, Christianity is much caught as it is taught. Certainly we need to teach the word, and faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But maybe live it out in such a way that people want to know the God that we serve. Amen? It says, at the appointed time, the way that I've called you to do it, not according to your way. Guys, we don't come to God our way in our time when we want to. We come to God as he calls us to. Amen? We don't come in our strength. We don't come in our ability. We come in humility and brokenness, desperate for him as he calls us. And so, they're going to be daily offerings, and each was significant in both how and when they were done. Look at verse 3. And you shall say to them, this is an offering made by fire, which you shall offer to the Lord, two male lambs in their first year without blemish, day by day, as a regular burnt offering. Now the burnt offering was completely consumed. Nothing was held back. They took two, in this case, they're taking two spotless lambs every morning. Two more lamb, you know, a lamb in the morning and lamb at night, and they're bringing them and they're sacrificing them completely to the Lord. Now, we're in John, and what did we just see when John the Baptist saw Jesus coming? What did he say? Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. For 1,500 plus years, they've been sacrificing lambs every single day. And as they're sacrificing lambs every single day, it's preparing them for the Lamb of God when he would come. Hundreds of thousands of lambs die in preparation for Jesus Christ to come. Amen? And it's all pointing to him. So they don't fully understand it. They don't know about the Lamb of God. They just know what God commands them to do. And guys, we don't always have to fully understand the whole picture. We just need to know what God has said and obey what he has said when he says to do it. Amen? Obey him. By the way, delayed obedience is disobedience. Amen? Well, Lord, I'll do that next week. That's disobedience. When God calls us to do it, we obey him right now. Amen? We don't want to miss out on God's highest. They were to be sacrificed continually until the Messiah came. Who put an end to this sacrifice that took place today? Who put an end to it? Jesus did. When Jesus, he said, it's finished. So day by day by day, year after year after year, day after day, morning, night, morning, night, morning, night, every day, hundreds of years, 1,500 plus years, all these years, and all of it, every day was never to stop, and it did, and was not supposed to stop until Jesus came. Amen? And only he puts a stop to it. And so this was a reminder to begin their day with him, to spend their day with him, to end their day with him, and this offering was completely consumed. The burnt offering is a picture of what our Savior did on the cross as he was completely poured out for us. He gave his life for us. Amen? Verse 4. The one lamb you shall offer in the morning, and the other lamb you shall offer in the evening. And again, offerings made every morning and every evening, made every day, just as we should begin our day with the Lord by giving ourselves completely to Him. The Christian life is to be a burnt offering. We don't give God some, we give God all. Amen? You've heard me say this. Pastor Chuck used to say, Christians don't tell lies, they just sing them. Right? I surrender all. Really? Amen? And Chuck would always say, more like, I surrender some when I feel like it. Amen? So we'll sing, I surrender all, but then if it's not convenient, not so much. Or if it's conflicting with something else I want to do, or allow the flesh. Guys, I want to tell you, the way that you'll grow in your faith is to spend time with the Lord every single day. Amen? Not just morning, but morning and evening. And this was God's reminder to them. Don't forget about me. Don't take your eyes off of me. Remember who you are. You're my kids. Remember, remind the next generation. So what would happen? As they would get up early in the morning and they go out to make sacrifice, and the kids are watching day after day as mom and dad are bringing the sacrifice, and the priests are bringing the sacrifice, and they see the flame, and they smell the sweet smelling aroma. What are the kids? Dad, mom and dad, why do they do that? Why are we doing that? Because God told us to. Amen? And we'll see as the feasts come along, they're going to ask about the feast, and each feast was pointing to something that God had done and was pointing to something that God was going to do. In the morning, they prepared for the day, and in the morning, we should prepare for our day. Pray in the morning for divine appointments. Pray in the morning if you know you're going to be interacting with coworkers, pray for them by name. For me, I have clients. I had a client today. I prayed for him this morning. Pray for him the beginning of the day. I know I'm going to see this attorney I've never met before. Give me an opportunity to share Jesus with him. Guess what? Opportunity to share Jesus with him. Amen? Because when we pray, prayer doesn't change God's mind. It changes our hearts. And it prepares us to be ready to be used by Him. And guys, have you ever noticed when you don't begin your day with the Lord, how quickly you get in the flesh? You're driving to work and, you know, you're getting mad at, you know, you're at the drive-thru. It's been 35 seconds. Where's my food? Oh, I guess you skipped your devotions this morning. Amen. Am I the only one? Okay. What I'm saying is, what you can tell, it changes everything when you begin the day with the Lord. And that was the command, that they would begin their day with Him and end their day with Him, that the sacrifice would be made continually, they would constantly smell the sweet-smelling aroma of the sacrifice unto the Lord. It was constant among the children of Israel. If you only pray at the end of the day, I can't remember which pastor said this, but he's so on the money. He goes, if all you do is pray at the end of the day, you're just going to spend all your time praying, confessing sin, asking for forgiveness. Your whole prayer life will be, I blew it then, and then I did this, and I blew that too, and Lord, forgive me. Well, and then I talked about it, and then I blew that, and then I did, yeah, and I blew that, and then I blew that, and then I blew. You know what? Start with prayer in the morning. Amen. And you might not have to have so much prayer of repentance that night. Amen? Pray in the morning, pray in the evening, seek the Lord. You know, it says in Psalm 3, my voice you shall hear in the morning. You read through the Psalms, it's always talking about meeting Him early in the morning, rising up early. You don't have time to spend with God before work? Get up earlier. Amen? Okay, I need my sleep, man. Really, I have Super Bowl tickets. We got to leave at 5 a.m. Who's going? Everyone's going. Amen? Amen. I hear the waves are going to be the best waves in the last 100 years. Surfers are going to stay up all night drinking Red Bull to make sure they get out there. Guys, it's the difference between passion and obligation. If you're doing it out of love for somebody, you'll get up early. Amen? If you're doing it out of obligation, you'll fall apart. Psalm 63 says, when I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night watches. So Psalm 5:3 says, my voice you shall hear in the morning. And then Psalm 63 says, when I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night watches. Let's meditate on Him in the morning. Let's begin our day with Him. Let's spend our day with Him. Let's end our day with Him. And your day is going to go a lot different when you make God the priority all day long. Amen? Verse 5-8. And then it says there, the one lamb you shall offer in the morning, the other in the evening, and one-tenth of an ephah, fine flour, as a grain offering, mixed with one f- fourth of a hin of pressed oil. It is a regular burnt offering which was ordained at Mount Sinai for a sweet aroma, an offering made by fire to the Lord. Fine flour means that it was beaten. To make flour fine, flour, you know, left to itself is lumpy and it's got, so they beat it to make it fine. And again, a picture of what happened to our Savior. He was beaten, amen? Pressed oil, how do you get oil? You know, oil press, that's what Gethsemane means, by the way. It means oil press. There, it was there where Jesus prayed and he sweat great drops of blood. But oil, again, an oil press, what it does is it puts pressure on the oil to purify it, to produce it. And guys, oil represents the Holy Spirit. And when we get squeezed, the Holy Spirit ought to pour out of us. Amen? We ought to produce a sweet-smelling aroma, right? You know, you find out what's on the inside when the item gets squeezed. Amen? You squeeze a lemon, you get lemonade, right? Or lemon juice. And when you squeeze a Christian, you ought to get Christ-likeness. By our fruit they shall know us. Amen? So it's beaten into fine flour, and it's mixed with oil. Oil, picture of the Holy Spirit. And it was ordained at Mount Sinai. When the law was given, the law revealed man's sin. So here's what God does. God never just reveals our sin and walks away. On Mount Sinai, he gave him the law, and he gave him the sacrificial system. Because the law shows us we're sinners, and the sacrificial system is what redeems us from our sin. Amen? It's pointing to the Messiah that's coming. Not the blood of bulls and goats that save us, but the one who the blood of bulls and goats was pointing to will save us. Amen? And so the point was this. It was to show, yeah, here's the law. We're sinners. Here's a way to live a holy life, but you're going to fall short. So don't feel like there's nothing you can do, because here's the sacrificial system. Here's the law, and here comes the grace of Jesus Christ. Amen? Our God doesn't just leave us in our sin. He brings the solution. He is the solution. The law and the sacrificial system were ordained by God at the same time. There was no time when they had the law when they didn't have a way to pay for their sin, to make sacrifices for the sins that they had committed. Verse 7. And its drink offering shall be one fourth of a hin for each lamb. In the holy place you shall pour out the drink to the Lord as an offering. The drink offering was made from wine. So you've got pressed oil. You've got a lamb. Right? You've got fine flour. And now you've got wine. What does the wine represent? The blood of Jesus Christ. The lamb, it's Jesus. He's the Lamb of God. The flour pressed, you know, beaten, our Savior suffered and died that we might have eternal life. Later, you know, when they had the offikomen and they pulled out the bread, right, the cracker, and they broke it. Again, a picture of Jesus made from what? Fine flour. And then on top of the fine flour, now you also had the oil, which represents the Holy Spirit, and now you've got the drink offering. So when they're doing all this, there's no way they could have fully comprehended what it all pointed to, but they were to do it anyway, because we do it out of faith in what God has commanded us to do. Amen? We look back and go, dude, that's Jesus. The lamb, that's Jesus. The flour, that's Jesus. The oil, Holy Spirit upon him. Blood poured out. Boy, that's the Lord. I see that clearly. Guys, let's obey him even when we do not yet see it clearly. Amen? 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 And notice what happens. It says, the other lamb you shall offer in the evening as the morning grain offering, and its drink offering you shall offer it as an offering made by fire, a sweet aroma to the Lord. Made by fire. Fire in the Bible speaks of trials. It speaks of purification of the saints. It's a picture of our Savior's suffering. You know, count all joy, my brethren. Amen? When you fall in the, you know, when you fall in the various trials. Because, guys, trials are coming. And God cares far more about your character than he does your comfort. And we want to escape. You know what? I want to say this. Our country and this generation we live in is the most comfort. One of the gods that we serve is the God of comfort. Is that true or not? Dude, I'm not comfortable. I'm staying here. Right? We want to be comfortable. When people plan their retirement, what do they say? I want to be what? I want to be comfortable when I retire. Everything's about being comfortable. He sent the comforter because you're not supposed to be comfortable. Amen? We don't find our comfort in making it easy on our flesh. We mold our character by allowing God to do a work in us when we're uncomfortable in our flesh and being led by the Spirit. Amen? By the way, and again, you may retire from your career, but you never retire from being a Christian. Amen? You never stop representing Him. You never stop serving the Lord. And sometimes to serve Him, you're going to have to get out of your comfort zone. You know why? It's tragic. I read somewhere over 90% of all Christians have never led one person to the Lord. And you know why? Because they're uncomfortable stepping out of their comfort zone to tell people about Jesus. Lord, may we live lives uncomfortable in our flesh and comforted by the Lord. Amen? These fiery trials are burning away the dross and making us more like our Savior. You take a piece of coal and you put a lot of pressure on it and you get a diamond. Amen? And guys, if we want to be more like Jesus, if we want to be pleasing to the Lord, if we want to be a sweet aroma to the Lord, we need to live lives sold out and set apart to Him, willing to be uncomfortable that He might be glorified. Lord, help us. Amen? The end result of going through the fire is we become pleasing to the Lord. It says in Isaiah 53, speaking of our Savior, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise Him. He has put Him to grief when you made His soul an offering for sin. The daily sacrifices began each day and ended with the statement of the need for atonement by sacrifice and the expression of devotion to the Lord. And He was saying to the next generation, don't you get in that land of promise and forget about Me. Don't you go enter into all that I have for you and get so caught up in doing what you're doing. And this can also happen when you're in ministry. You can make the ministry a substitute for Jesus if you're not careful. Amen? Where you're striving after doing ministry, you're striving after doing the thing you've always done instead of making sure that you're in love with Jesus first. Everything we do ought to flow out of our love for Him. So point number one, rediscovering God's plan through the daily offerings. It was a sweet aroma to the Lord. How do we do that? We put our flesh to death. It's a picture of the cross. We begin, spend, and end our day with Him. Number two, taking time to worship, fellowship, and rest in Him. Look at verses 9 and 10. It says in verse 9, and on the Sabbath day, two lambs in the first year without blemish and 2/10 of an ephah of fine flour as a grain offering mixed with oil and with its drink offering. This is the burnt offering for every Sabbath besides the regular burnt offering with its drink offering. The Sabbath day, fourth commandment, was remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And this is the first instruction concerning Sabbath ritual. The same offerings as the other days with additional sacrifice. There was a greater emphasis on the Sabbath day to have a focus on the Lord, which meant they spent more time preparing the sacrifice, which meant they spent more time in God's presence on that day, which meant that there was more being offered up to the Lord on that day. And you know what? We need, every day is the Lord's day for us and under the new covenant. But that being said, we need to have a day where we do nothing but focus on God and we're not distracted by our jobs, by our hobbies, by anything else. He's the priority. And I long for those days. I think we've gotten away from that. Amen? If you're church on a Sunday, dude, it's 11:29. You better wrap this up. Amen? Surf's up. Tea time. Go home, watch the Raiders lose again or whatever, right? Whatever these things are that we again, and I used to love it when I was a kid. Now, you've seen these memes, right? By the way, I know what a meme is. I'm in my 50s. I'm scared. That scares me a little bit. But you see these kids, and they're like sitting there, and it's like this little kid, and he's in a suit, and he's sitting there, and you can tell he's like worn out. He's like, it's like that time when you know you want to go home, but your dad's a pastor. I see one of the kids laying on the floor. I used to fall asleep in pews and my dad would drive all the way home and have to come back and get me because I was asleep from the Wednesday night service. I'd get home from, where's David? Oh, get back in the car, go back, turn the lights on and find me in church. But you know what I loved? Sundays at my house growing up, we went to church And every Sunday, we had someone over for lunch. We never knew who it was going to be, but my mom put a roast in that oven. There was no microwave. You put a roast in the oven before you go to church, and then you invite people home, and the whole day, and then we would hang out for 3 or 4 hours and talk, and then we'd get back in the car and drive back for Sunday night church. And that's how I grew up. And that's what the Lord's talking about in the Sabbath. The Sabbath day, that special day, was a day where we're going to make this about God today. Amen? Now look, God knows you go to work, and it's a God day every day, but there's something special about it. I'm not going to work today. I'm not chasing after something else today. This is the God day. Amen? And I'm going to give him this entire day. And that's what he's reminding this next generation to do. It's a day of rest. It's a day of devotion. It was a reminder to keep a day of worship set apart. There was more work for the priests on the Sabbath and more rest for everyone else. Amen? And praise the Lord for that. And so there's a need. And again, today, every day is the Lord's day. We were to continue to take time to worship and fellowship and rest in him. Why is he giving these instructions? They're about to go in the land of promise. Moses is going to go to heaven. They're going to go in, and he wants them, don't forget me when you get there. Remember all that God has done. Final point, taking time to celebrate and commemorate. So take time to worship and fellowship and rest in him. A day of rest and devotion to make God the priority, to fellowship and worship, make that a priority. And again, if you're too busy to gather on the Lord's day, you need to repent. You need to change your priorities. Amen? Seek first the kingdom. Nobody's laying on their deathbed wishing they had worked more. Amen? Nobody's saying, I wish I'd done more of this or done more of that. It's, man, I wish I'd done more for the kingdom of God and more with my family. Amen? Let's make that a priority. So now the last thing is to take time to celebrate and commemorate who Jesus is and all that he has done for us. Look at verse 11. So along with daily sacrifices, he talked about weekly sacrifices on the Sabbath day, and now he's going to talk about monthly sacrifices. Look what it says. At the beginning of your months, you shall present a burnt offering to the Lord, 2 young bulls, 1 ram, and 7 lambs in their first year without blemish. The beginning of each month, 2 bulls, 1 ram, 7 lambs without blemish. Each one of these is a picture of our Savior. 7 in the Bible is number of completion or perfection. Amen. And 7 lambs that were perfect in the sense of no blemish. They weren't sick. They weren't wounded. You know, they needed to be perfect lambs. And this was held as a monthly sacred festival. Trumpets were blown over the sacrifices. No work was done. It was a time of public worship. Social and family feasts took place. And again, new moon festivals were common among the heathen. This new festival would be given, give the minds of the people of Israel direction back to the Lord and not to the world. I know I'm going to blow some people's gig right now, and it's okay. I'm not a Halloween guy. I'm just not. I never took my kids trick-or-treating, ever. Never did it. My grandkids go, okay. I don't get, you know why? Because I want to focus on things that glorify my Savior. Amen? And we did have, I forgot what we called it. What do we call, babe? We had the, what do you call it? Harvest Festival. So we'd have this thing and everybody would dress up. I remember my kids dressing up like Joseph with the multicolored coat and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And then we'd go and it'd be, you know, David and Goliath. You get to swing it. And have the stuff that was Christ-centered and still gave them candy. It's okay to have candy. But point is that I want, and here's the scarier part to me. Halloween's nowhere in any way got anything to do with Jesus. But what's scarier to me is Christ is being left out of Christmas and out of Resurrection Sunday. Amen? And by the way, I was told by a few people we should skip church on Christmas this year. And guess what? That's what we ain't going to do. Amen? Now, this place is closed on Christmas Day, so we're going to have a December 21st Saturday morning service. It's closed on New Year's Eve, or New Year's, so we're going to have a New Year's Eve service because that's when they're open. But we're not skipping. Guys, it's about Jesus. Amen? I will blow off every present and burn the tree down in my house before we're skipping church on Christmas. Amen? Well, it's a family time. You're right. And he's our dad. And it's his birthday. And we're not leaving him out. Amen? Can you imagine if someone invited you to a birthday party and you showed up and nobody talked to you, none of them acknowledged you, and they gave each other a bunch of gifts and sang song about a red-nosed reindeer and forgot all about you? You want to come to that party next year? Not so much. Guys, it's all about Jesus, amen? And he wanted to remind them, as these feasts come, we're going to be reminded about the Lord. We're not going to forget about the Lord. We're going to keep the priority on God. It's about God. That's why we get up in the morning making sacrifices. Why? Because of God. He commanded us. It's because of his grace that's coming. It's because of the sacrifice. Blood must be shed to pay for my sin. It's a constant reminder. And guys, we must never allow this generation that comes behind us to forget what it's all about. He says there are 3/10 of an ephah of fine flour of grain offering mixed with oil for each bull. 2/10 of an ephah of fine flour is a grain offering mixed with the oil for one ram. 1/10 of an ephah of fine flour mixed with oil as a grain offering for each lamb, as a burnt offering of sweet aroma, an offering made by fire to the Lord. Their drink offering shall be 1/2 hin of wine for a bull, 1/3 of a hin for a ram, 1/4 of a hin for the lamb. And this is a burnt offering for each month throughout the months of the year. Do you notice that, again, our God's a God of order? Amen? He doesn't just say, sacrifice whatever you want, give whatever you want. We found out that didn't work out. Ask Cain. Amen? Well, I know I'm supposed to bring an animal, but I'm a farmer, so I'm going to bring fruits and vegetables. More proof that God loves meat more than fruits and vegetables. I'm just saying. The guy that brought the vegan diet, God did not accept it. Amen? God bless you if you're a vegan. More meat for me. I'm good with it, okay? But the point I'm making is this, that God clearly tells us why we bring what we bring, and if we deviate from it, it's because we do not understand that God has a purpose. Every ephah of flour, the oil represents the Holy Spirit. The flour, again, beaten and fine. The animals that are dying, they all point to our Savior on the cross of Calvary. Guys, we don't come to God our way. We come to God his way. There's only one way, only one truth, only one hope, only one life, and there's only one sacrifice, Jesus Christ. And we don't deviate from that a little bit. Jesus plus nothing equals salvation. Verse 15, also 1 kid of the goats as a sin offering to the Lord shall be offered besides a regular burnt offering and its drink offering. The goat was a sin offering, again, a type or a picture of Christ. Unlike the burnt offering, it was not completely consumed. It was partially eaten. And again, the pagans, the Egyptians and the Syrians offered goats to the moon gods. Guys, it's not enough just to make an offering. It needs, in hopes of pleasing God, but it must be made according to God's command. It's not just sacrificing anything. It's not trying to come to God in any way. It's got to come to God his own way, his way. Amen? You've heard that term scapegoat, where they would confess, you know, later on the Day of Atonement, they would take 2 goats, one was sacrificed, they confessed the sins over another, and they sent it out in the wilderness, you know, carrying the sins as far as the east is from the west. And all these sacrifices are being made, and they all point to the Lord. So here's what we have so far. Every day, morning and evening, continual sacrifice. There's a sacrifice in the morning, sacrifice in the evening, every day. On the Sabbath, additional sacrifices were made. Sabbath unique from all other days. And then at the beginning of each month, again, there was a feast that was made, more sacrifices were made, trumpets were blown, all reminders of both man's need for atonement and the calling to dedicate his life to God, to begin his day by looking up, to seek the Lord, to never think he can do this without the sacrifice, without seeking God. You know why our lives are a mess? Because we live our lives without the Lord in them. Amen? We live according to our flesh and our ways. We disregard the word of God and we listen to the culture. And what does the culture think? What does the world think? What do men think? Let's vote on whether or not we think we should still do this. Well, the Bible's an old, antiquated book. Well, we don't have to follow that anymore. Wait till you're married to have intimacy. Honor God in all that you do. Be not drunk with wine. We just legalized pot. Guess what? It's still sin. Amen? Well, it's legal. So is adultery. Amen? Is adultery legal? Can you do? They throw you in jail for adultery? Is it sin? OK, Okay? So don't give me, don't even try to, well, pot's illegal, Pastor Dave, and it grows right up out of the ground, man. So if God didn't want us to smoke it, he wouldn't have grown it. You've heard me say it before. Smoke some poison oak. It grows up out of the ground. See how that works out for you. Smoke some uranium. Try that. Mercury. That stuff in the ground. Amen? Guys, God's word is true. We follow him and not what the world tells us to do. There are also annual feasts. Let's pick up the pace because we need to finish up here. But we're going to see these seven feasts over the next 2 weeks. And if you go to Leviticus 23, or if you go on our website and listen to Leviticus 23, there's four feasts that took part in the, I believe it's in the spring, right? Pastor Mark, do you remember the first four in the spring and the last three in the fall, I think. Is that right? Okay. So the first four feasts take part in one part of the year, and then there's a lapse of time, and then the last three feasts. And the first four feasts were fulfilled in the first coming of Christ, and the last three feasts are going to be fulfilled when Jesus comes back. And so, but when they're doing this feast, they're always looking back to an event behind them, not realizing it's pointing to an event in front of them. So we're going to look at the first two right here. The first one's Passover. It says in verse 16, on the 14th day of the first month is the Passover of the Lord. And on the 15th day of this month is a feast. Unleavened bread shall be eaten for 7 days. Now, what is leaven a picture of? Sin. So unleavened bread is a picture of something or someone who is sinless. Amen? So who's the unleavened bread pointing to? Jesus Christ. And they had the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which was a part of Passover. And what would they do? They would go through their house and make sure there's no leaven. Amen? By the way, that's a good thing for us to do. Amen? Cleanse our house of the sinful things that are lying around there. These feasts, they mean appointed times, set times of commemoration and celebration of the things that God had done for them. And we're going to see these feasts first. One right here is Passover, then the Feast of Unleavened Bread, then the Feast of First Fruits, then the Feast of Pentecost. Then there's an expanse of time, and you get to the fall, and there's the Feast of Trumpets, the Feast, the Day of Atonement, and then the Feast of Tabernacles. As you see on that outline there, Passover points to the cross. Unleavened bread to risen and living Savior, triumphed over sin and death. The Feast of First Fruits, the resurrection. Pentecost, the giving of the Holy Spirit. The Feast of Trumpets, the rapture of the church, the trumpet will blow. The Day of Atonement, the great tribulation, that time when the tribulation will come. And then finally, Tabernacles, when they would encamp and we're going to rule and reign with him upon the earth for 1,000 years. But at that time, they were just looking back. And he was commanding them to honor each of these feasts and to do exactly what he said. So the 14th day of the first month, again, they had a lunar calendar. It would be March or April for us. It was the 14th day of the first month. It's called Nisan. And they celebrated annually on the actual day when they were delivered out of bondage. So they had been in bondage 430 years, and every year when that day came around, they stopped what they were doing, and they remembered God's deliverance out of bondage. They were to never forget. They were to take time to celebrate. When they took the blood of the Lamb in the shape of a cross, and the angel of death passed over, and they were delivered out of bondage after being, in the world and enslaved by the things of the world and surrounded by idolatry, and God delivered them, and they were to never forget. And Passover was a time to remember what God had done when Pharaoh was reluctant to let them go, but our God brought victory over the world. And again, in that picture, what happened in Passover. Unless there was blood in the basin and upon the sides and at the top of the door, if the blood had not been applied, they would die. It wasn't enough to slaughter the lamb and pour the blood in the basin. If you just believed that the blood had been shed, or if you believed that the sacrifice was made, that's not enough. Guys, we can believe that Jesus died on the cross. We can believe that we can even believe that he rose from the dead. But guys, if the blood isn't applied to my life, if I've not made him Lord and Savior, if it's not washed away my sin, what he did for all of mankind. It's offered universally, but it must be accepted individually. And nobody else can put the blood on the doorpost of your life but you. Amen? You have to ask God, Lord, me, forgive me. I need to be forgiven. It's a picture of the cross. Historically, it was in celebration of their deliverance from Egyptian bondage. It says there, on the first day you shall have a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work. You shall do no work on the day of Passover. Do no work on the day of Passover. You know why? Because you didn't get saved because of any work. Amen? On the day that they're remembering their deliverance out of bondage, on the day that they're remembering the feast that's pointing to the cross, there's no work done on that day because Jesus plus nothing equals salvation. 1 Corinthians 5 says, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Again, our salvation came through his blood shed, not our good works. Then it says there, again there in verse 19, you shall present an offering made by fire as a burnt offering to the Lord. Two young bulls, one ram, seven lambs in their first year. Be sure they are without blemish. Why do they have to be without blemish? Why? Because they point to Jesus and he is without sin. Amen? So again, don't come to God with an animal with a broken leg. Don't give God the worst that you've got. You give God the best because it all points to him. Amen? I love that picture. And he says there, their grain offering shall be of fine flour mixed with oil, 3/10 of an ephah you shall offer for a bull and 2/10 for a ram. You shall offer 1/10 of an ephah for each of the seven lambs. Also one goat as a sin offering to make what? What does it say? Atonement for you. All the way back, before they even entered into the land of promise, he's telling them, you need to make these sacrifices. And part of the sacrifice, its job is to make an atonement for you. You're going to take that animal, hold it in your hands, slit its throat, its blood is shed, the animal is sacrificed, and he's dying in your place. All of that, again, pointing to the Savior. All these things he's telling them as they're standing, looking across the Jordan, there's the land of promise. He doesn't want them to get into the land of promise and forget about him. Guys, may we never get to the place where we're so comfortable that we forget about him, or where God blesses us so much that we cease to be desperate for him. Amen? Lord, bring a little desperation into my life. Who prayed that prayer recently? Lord, make me uncomfortable, please, in Jesus' name. Why? Because you know what? Those are the things that keep us desperate for the Lord. Verse 23, you shall offer these besides the burnt offering in the morning, which is for regular burnt offering. In this manner, you shall offer the food of the offering made by fire daily for 7 days as a sweet aroma to the Lord. It shall be offered besides the regular burnt offering and its drink offering. And on the seventh day, you shall have a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work. Again, it's a sacrifice that redeems us, not our good works. We need to be reminded that we're sinners in need of a Savior. We must never take it for granted. And we read this. It's exhausting reading this. What was it like to, okay, what day is it now? And how many sacrifices we got to? We got the thing and the thing. Oh, today we got the, oh, and it's the first of the month. So we got the ram, and then we got the, okay, and then we have to have the, and the doves on the, and we got to make sure, and the oil press. Who's got the oil, right? Can you imagine? Right? You're making the sacrifice. Oh, that lamb's no good. We need 4 good ones. And we're going to need 2 more tomorrow. So, you know, I mean, it was a constant reminder that they could never just let it go. They had to always be reminded of the grace of God and the power of God and the sacrifices that were needed for them to be saved. They must never forget, never take it lightly. Lord, help us to never forget. Amen. As we finish up, and it says, finally, we had the feast of Passover. And again, Passover pointing to the cross of Calvary, pointing to what Jesus would do for us. Again, the 3 pieces of bread, one broken and wrapped and hidden. It's a holy convocation. It says they're a time of sacred and consecrated assembly. Again, it was something that we didn't take lightly. It wasn't something they blew off because the waves were good or NASCAR was on TV or there was a sale at the mall or whatever. Amen? It was a holy convocation. God's first. Make him the priority. Make him the passion. Don't let anything else become more important than him. Now, the Feast of Weeks is also known as what? Feast of First Fruits. Amen. The Feast of Weeks, this is what it says here. Also on the day of first fruits, when you bring a new grain offering to the Lord at your Feast of Weeks, you shall have a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work. You shall present a burnt offering as a sweet aroma to the Lord, 2 young bulls, 1 ram, and 7 lambs in their first year, with a grain offering of fine flour with oil, 3/10 of an ephah for each bull, 2/10 and for the 1 ram, and 1/10 for each of the 7 lambs, also 1 kid of the goats to make atonement for you. Be sure they are without blemish. You shall present them with their drink offerings besides the regular burnt offering with its grain offering. So the Feast of First Fruits, we got the picture of the cross, and the next feast is a picture of what? It's on your, you got a cheat sheet right in front of you. It's right there. The resurrection, amen. So the feast that first points to the cross is followed up by the feast that points to the resurrection, and this is 1,500 roughly years before Jesus came. And he's reminding them, guys, what if we just had the Passover? I'm thinking we need the resurrection. Amen? We don't partially portray the Lord. By the way, that's what a lot of the world does. Well, I'd like that God of love and grace and kumbaya and sit around trees and sing songs. But I don't like that Old Testament God that brings righteous judgment when you don't follow him. It's the same God. Amen? And he's a God of love and grace and mercy, but he's also a God of righteous judgment. Lord, help us. Amen? 7 lambs, the number of perfection. 1 ram, 2 bulls, 10 total. Again, the 7 lambs, Jesus is the Lamb of God. 7 is the number of completeness. The bull is a beast of burden. He took all of our burdens upon him. His yoke is easy. His burden is light. And the ram, just remember as we finish up, that when Abraham took Isaac up on the mountain, you guys remember this? And when he was carrying the wood, his only begotten son, he referred him to, even though he had another son, because it wasn't his only son, it was his uniquely called and gifted son, a picture of Jesus. And Isaac says to his father, we have the wood and we have the fire, but where's the sacrifice? And then Moses said, God will provide himself a sacrifice. Read the text. He doesn't say God will provide for himself. He says God will provide himself a sacrifice. And as he raises up the knife in his hand to sacrifice his son, as his son freely lays down and gives up his life, because Isaac wasn't a little boy when this happened, contrary to the cartoons you might see. He was big enough and strong enough to overtake his dad, was over 100 years old. He could have whipped him. But he freely laid down his life because he loved his dad and he trusted his dad and he trusted the God, his God. Amen? And then as he held up this knife, then God stopped him and said, now I know, Abraham. You'll never put anything before me. And when they looked, what did they see caught in a thicket? A ram. Did God know there was going to be a ram? Of course he did. And here they are making the sacrifice. And what's it all pointing to? Pointing to Jesus. Amen? He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So, handing down the truth to the next generation. Rediscovering God's plan every single day. Being reminded every day. Being thankful every day. Being worshipful every day. Examining your heart before God every day. Spending time in God's word every day. Spending time in prayer every day. Beginning your day with the Lord. Spending your day with the Lord. And ending your day with the Lord. Number 2, take time to worship and fellowship and rest in him. Again, set a day apart to worship. Set a day apart to make God the priority. Don't let anything else distract you. Don't plan church around stuff. Plan stuff around church. Amen? Seek first the kingdom of God. And then finally, take time to celebrate and commemorate who Jesus is and all that he has done for us. Don't fall into the trap of watering down the truth of the gospel by making the days that represent him to represent something else. Amen? don't know about you, but Numbers 28, it's an encouragement to me to get up tomorrow morning and once again begin my day with Him. How about you? Heavenly Father, we love You, we praise You, we worship You, Lord. I thank You. I know this was kind of a tedious chapter, but Lord, it's in Your Word for a reason. I thank You for every person who's here, none by chance, but all by divine appointment. And Lord, as they were reminded, I pray we've been reminded tonight to never take You for granted, to never take You lightly, to never give You the place of honor You deserve. Forget that, Lord. Fill us with Your Spirit afresh. Help us to be the men and women of God You want us to be. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Let's stand and worship.